So maybe we can start. So welcome to the seminar. It's a great pleasure to have today Ivan Velinic from the Université de Genève. And he will speak about the failure of the Einstein-Zernick asymptotics for the Perl correlation function at high temperature and small density. Thank you, Velinic.
Thank you. And thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure to have this opportunity to speak here. So, the topic I will talk about, as the title indicates, is about the domain of validity of the Einstein-Zernick asymptotics for two-point functions. And it's based on the recent joint work with my PhD student, Yassine Aoun. You can see my cursor.
Yes.
So with my PhD student, Yassine Aoun, my former student, Sébastien Hoth, and my longtime collaborator and close friend for over 20 years, Dima Yoffe, who sadly passed away last year. So I will start with a brief introduction. So in the early 20th century, two physicists, Einstein and Zernike, developed a theory of correlations in fluids. And among the many consequences of their theory, they were the first to establish the asymptotic behavior of the density-density correlations in fluids. So the idea is the following. So you have some fluid and you measure the density at some point zero, say, and some point X, and you want to understand the correlations between these two densities that you have measured. And what they showed based on their theory was that this correlation, G of R, R is the distance between the two points, behaves asymptotically when R becomes very large, in the following way. So there is an exponential decay with a rate that I denote by nu, which is known as the inverse correlation length. So 1 over nu is the correlation length of the system. And the prefactor, which is a power law, with a very specific exponent, which is d minus 1 over 2. So this type of asymptotic behavior is what I will call Einstein-Zernike behavior or Einstein-Zernike asymptotics in this talk. Okay. So it was realized rather early, certainly already in the 60s and possibly even before, that their theory fails if you get very close to a critical point. So if your fluids undergo a second order phase transition and you get very close to this point of second order phase transition or at the point of second order phase transition, then the correlation length in your system blows up. And this means that this inverse correlation length vanishes at the critical point. So at the critical point, the exponential decay disappears, and their theory would predict a behavior which is given by R to the power minus D minus 1 over 2. And while it's correct that the behavior is typically a power law at the critical point, the exponent is completely wrong. So nevertheless, all physicists believe that if you go away from the critical point, then you should recover Einstein-Zernike behavior. This should work. In particular, if you go very far away from the critical point, say at very high temperature or very low densities, then you should certainly see the Einstein-Zernike behavior, at least for systems with fast, quickly decaying interactions, say exponentially fast, exponentially decaying interactions. So what I will explain in this talk is that, in fact, the situation is much more subtle and interesting than was previously thought. So to keep things simple in this talk, I will focus on the easing model on ZD, but many things that I will say are valid more generally, and sometimes I will mention extensions when they are available and relevant. Okay, but mostly I will talk about the easing model. So let me fix some notation. So I will denote by H the magnetic field of the model, and I will also consider a family JX indexed by the site of the lattice, ZD, of non-negative constants, which I assume satisfy J of 0 is 0, J of X is equal to J of minus X, and the GX are summable. So with this, I can define associate an energy to configurations, and I'll do it in this way. So I consider a finite subset lambda of the lattice, and then I consider a configuration sigma on lambda, which means just an assignment of a spin plus or minus 1 at each vertex of lambda. And if you give yourself such a configuration sigma, then you can associate an energy to this configuration through this Hamiltonian function, H lambda of sigma, which is made up of two terms. So the first term here encodes the contribution to the energy coming from the interaction between the spins in the box. So the contribution to the energy coming from the spin located at x and y in the box is given by minus the coupling constant j of y minus x, which measures the effect of the relative position of the sites x and y times the product sigma x sigma y. And then the second term is just the usual coupling of the magnetic field H with the total magnetization in the box lambda. Okay, so the usual Hamiltonian of the easing model with some coupling constant J. Now, once you have the energy, you can define using the usual recipe, you can define the Gibbs measure in the finite box lambda. So the Gibbs measure in lambda is a probability measure on configuration defined on lambda. It depends on a parameter beta, which is assumed to be non-negative. It's interpreted as the inverse temperature. So 1 over beta is the temperature of the system. And this probability assigns, so this Gibbs measure assigns a probability to a configuration sigma, which is proportional to exponential of minus beta times the energy of the configuration sigma. So this is a Gibbs measure. It's a probability measure on finite configuration or configuration on finite subsets of ZD. And in this talk, I will be interested in Gibbs measures on infinite configurations on ZD. For this one, there are many ways of defining these measures on infinite configurations. And one simple way is to take weak limits of finite volume measures. And that's the way I'm going to do it. So I will define an infinite volume Gibbs measure as follows. So when the magnetic field is non-zero, I will define the measure p beta h as the weak limit of a sequence of measure p lambda beta h, which are finite volume Gibbs measure as introduced above, for a growing sequence of finite subsets lambda of ZD, which converges to ZD. Okay, so such a sequence converges and defines me a measure p beta h. Now, when h is equal to zero, one has to be a bit more careful, and the measure I'm interested in will be constructed as follows. So I define p beta zero, as follows. So I'm taking this measure p beta h that we have already defined for some, say, strictly positive value of h, and then I let h decrease towards zero and take the weak limit of these measures, and this defines me the measure when h is equal to zero. Okay, so these are the infinite volume measures that I will be interested in this talk. Now, the main quantity that we are interested in is the two-point function. It's the analog of this density-density correlation that Ornstein and Zernike studied in their paper. So it's defined as follows. So it's a function on ZD, which I will denote by g beta h. So it's the covariance under this infinite volume Gibbs measure p beta h of the spin at the origin and the spin located at point x of the lattice. Okay. Now this quantity, this two-point function, usually decays exponentially fast with the distance between the two spins. And for this reason, it's very convenient to introduce a notation for the rate of exponential decay of these covariances. And I will denote it as follows. So in general, the rate of decay of the covariance depends on the direction of x with respect to the origin, direction in which x is going when you let it go to infinity. So I'm fixing a direction s, so a unit vector in Rd, which I call s. And then the inverse correlation length in direction s is the quantity which I will denote nu beta h of s. And it's just defined as usual. So you look at the two-point function, so the covariance between the spin at zero and the spin which is located at a distance n in direction s from the origin. Usually ns is not a point on ZD, it's a point on Rd. So this square bracket here is just to say that you take, for instance, the closest point on ZD. Doesn't matter how you do it. You get the same limit. So you take this two-point function, take its log, divide by n, change the sign, take the limit as n goes to infinity, and this gives you the rate of decay in direction s, rate of exponential decay. Now, as I said just before, this two-point function usually decays exponentially fast, which should mean that this function nu is usually positive. And this can be made very precise. What you can prove is the following. So there exists a critical value of the inverse temperature that I will denote by beta c. It's strictly positive, but it can be infinite, for instance, in dimension one, such that for any pair beta h except one, there is just one bad point, but for all other pairs beta h, the inverse correlation length is strictly positive, so that the two-point function indeed decays exponentially fast with the distance. And at the particular pair beta c zero, at the critical point, then the inverse correlation length vanishes. It's the only point where you don't have exponential decay. So in this talk, I'm interested in the regime where you do have exponential decay. We already know that Ornstein-Zernike behavior does not work at the critical point. So I'm gonna ignore this case beta C zero and only concentrate on all the other pairs beta and h. Now, if I do that, then in this case, this function nu beta h, which up to now I have only defined as function on the sphere, they can be extended to function on RD by positive homogeneity. So I can set nu beta h of x as being nu beta h of x hat, which is just a unit vector in the direction of x, multiplied by the Euclidean norm of x. So this will always denote the Euclidean norm. Okay. And it turns out that this function nu beta h of x that you have just defined on RD is a norm on RD. Okay. So now I think I have everything I need to start discussing what is known about the validity of this prediction by Ornstein and Zernike about the asymptotic behavior of the two-point function. And I will do that separately first for what is known about finite range interactions, where there are older results and more things that are known. And then I will turn to the case of infinite range interactions. So finite range interaction just means that there exists some number r, which is finite, such that if you take two points x and y on your lattice, which are at a distance larger than r, then there is no direct interaction between these two points. Okay, the corresponding coupling constant is zero. Okay, so finite range interactions. So in this case, there are two regimes which have been studied. One regime which is very well understood that I will speak about first, and then a second regime which is much less understood that I will also present quickly. So the first regime which is well understood is the following. So it's a regime where either the magnetic field is non-zero, or the magnetic field is zero, but you are above the critical temperature, which means that beta is smaller than beta C. Okay. So if you are in this regime, then the prediction by Ornstein and Zernike always holds. It's always true. And a precise statement can be found in this theorem. So it states that as n goes to infinity, the two-point function, so the covariance between the spin at zero and the spin at ns, decays exponentially fast with n with a rate which is given by the inverse correlation length, but that's kind of trivial. It follows immediately from the definition of nu. Okay. And then what is more interesting is the prefactor, and the prefactor indeed behaves like one over n to the power d minus 1 over 2, as predicted by Ornstein and Zernike. There is a numerator here, psi, which depends on the direction, and one can show that it depends analytically on the direction, actually, and one can also show that this inverse correlation length depends analytically on the direction. Okay, so in a very strong sense, one can show that Ornstein-Zernike prediction is correct in this setting. This result has a very long history. I'm just giving here some pointers. The first result of this type was obtained in 66 by Wu. And then his results were extended 10 years later in a joint work with various collaborators, which I list here. And what they did is the following. So they were looking at the easing model. I write in dimension two, but it's really in dimension two on a planar graph. So they look at the easing model on a planar graph when h is equal to zero. And then in this case, the easing model, as you probably know, is integrable. It's exactly solvable. And you can compute all kinds of quantities. In particular, you can compute explicitly this two-point function, which is written here, right? And then you can see by inspection that it has the form which is predicted by Ornstein and Zernike. Now, the first result that is true for any dimension was obtained in the 70s. By various people. The first groups to have obtained this result were Abraham and Kunz, and then Pais-Lemé. So the result applies in any dimension when h is zero, but only applies at very high temperature. So these are perturbative results that are only verified at very high temperature. The first non-perturbative result of this type, so valid up to beta C, was obtained nearly 20 years ago with Massimo Campanino and Dima in a joint work. And we extended it a few years later to arbitrary POTS models. And then the first, as far as I know, the only result for H non-zero was obtained very recently. It was published last year by Sébastien. It applies in any dimension for any beta, provided that H is non-zero. So as you can see, for this setting, everything is known basically. Okay, regarding this particular issue. Now, second regime is when H is equal to zero and beta is larger than beta C. That's what remains, right? And here the knowledge is much less complete. What you can show is the following. So as N becomes very large, the two-point function, the same as before, So again, of course, it decays exponentially fast with a rate which is given by the inverse correlation length by definition. But then the prefactors, in the planar case, it was shown that the prefactor violates Einstein-Zernike prediction. So in the planar case, you are of course two-dimensional. The exponent predicted by Einstein-Zernike is d minus 1 over 2, which should be 1/2. So you should add the square root of n in the denominator, and you have an n square. So you don't have Einstein-Zernike in this case. But turns out that in higher dimension, at least for very low temperature, you recover Einstein-Zernike always. Okay. So the first result in the planar case appeared in this paper already mentioned by Wu and collaborators. And again, it's based on an explicit computation of the two-point function. The second result is due to Brickmo and Froelich in the 80s. Maybe I make two quick comments. So the result by Brickmo and Froelich is expected to be true for any beta larger than beta C, but it's an open problem. We don't know how to do that. And then the second comment is that this violation of Einstein-Zernike that you have in the planar case, it's expected not to be a two-dimensional phenomenon, but expected to be a planar phenomenon. So it's really an artifact of the planarity of the graph and not of the fact that you're in two dimensions. So what is conjectured is that if you take an Ising model on a two-dimensional graph, which is non-planar, so periodic but non-planar, you should recover Einstein-Zernike behavior also in two dimensions. Okay, but that's completely open up to now. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say about the finite range case. And I would like now to turn to the case of infinite range interactions where our recent results apply. And for simplicity from now on, I will assume that the magnetic field is zero always, and I will omit it from the notations. But almost everything that I'm going to say also applies when H is non-zero. Okay, so there are three classes of interaction that I want to treat separately because they will behave in very different ways. So I will first look at interactions that decay slower than any exponential, what I will call sub-exponential decay of interactions. Then I will look at interactions that decay faster than any exponential, the super-exponential decay of interactions. And then finally, I will look at interactions that decay exactly exponentially fast. Okay, so let's start with those that decay slower than any exponential. By this, I mean that if you take any positive constant C and you look at E exponential of Cx times Jx, this and let x go to infinity, then this goes to plus infinity, which means that Jx does not decay faster than, decay slower than any exponential. Okay. So in this case, it has been known at least since the 60s. So the earlier paper on this that we found is a paper by Widom in 64. That for ferromagnetic systems, like the one we are considering here, the two-point function cannot decay faster than the interaction. Intuitively, it's pretty obvious. So if you look at the covariance between the spin at zero and the spin at x, among the cause of the fact that there is a correlation between these two spins is the fact that you have a direct interaction between sigma zero and sigma x. So it's very unlikely, except if you have strange cancellation occurring, that sigma, that the correlation could decay faster than the direct interaction that you have between the two. And in a ferromagnetic system, this cancellation cannot occur. So you can prove that indeed the two-point function never decays faster than the interaction. Okay, but this means immediately that for this kind of interaction, which decays slower than an exponential, Einstein-Zernike never holds. Why? Because Einstein-Zernike predicts an exponential decay of the two-point function, and our coupling constant by assumption decays slower than exponential. So two-point function must decay slower than exponential and thus violate the Einstein-Zernike prediction. Okay, but it turns out that in fact, in this case, one can compute explicitly the asymptotic again. It will not be of Einstein-Zernike form, but we can compute it. This was done by Newman and Spohn in the late 1990s in a paper that was never published for some reason. And the result is as follows. So as x becomes very large, the two-point function, g beta of x, becomes asymptotically proportional to the coupling constant Jx. And the proportionality constant is actually explicit. It's beta chi beta square, where chi beta is the so-called magnetic susceptibility of the model. Okay. So they did it for the Ising model. It was recently extended to POTS model last year, actually, by Yassin. Okay. So this is what is known about sub-exponential decay of interactions. So now let's look at super-exponential decay. So I'm assuming now that my coupling constant decay faster than any exponential, in the sense that for any CD in R, if you look at the exponential of CX times JX and you let X go to infinity, this goes to zero, which means that the decay of your coupling constant kills any exponential growth. So in this case, what can be proved, that's a recent, it's a work in progress, but this part is essentially finished, a work in progress with Yacine and Sébastien. What we can show is that everything I told you about what happens when beta is smaller than beta C in finite range models is still true in this case. So one has exactly the same kind of Ornstein-Zernike asymptotics that we had for finite range models. Okay. So the conclusion up to now is that if your interactions decay slower than any exponential, you never have Ornstein-Zernike. If it decays faster than any exponential, you always have Ornstein-Zernike. So of course, the most interesting case is the critical case, which is just in between, which is when the interaction decays exponentially fast with the distance. So let's look at that now. So I'm assuming that coupling constant Gx now behaves like, so there is an exponential decay, decays an exponential of minus some norm, which I will denote by this triple norm of X. It's some arbitrary norm on RD, it's not necessarily the Euclidean norm, any norm. That's the exponential decay part. And then I allow the decay to be not a pure exponential. You could have sub-exponential corrections to this pure exponential decay. And all these sub-exponential corrections, I put them into this prefactor psi of x. Okay. Now, for simplicity in this talk, I will make some assumption, additional assumption on this prefactor. I will assume that psi of x is actually just a function of the triple norm of x, and that it's strictly positive, just to simplify a bit the discussion. Okay. So the first thing I would like to discuss is what is the behavior of the inverse correlation length in this setting. So we are interested in what happens in the interval beta zero, beta c. So the first thing one should investigate is what happens in the limit when beta gets very close to beta c or beta gets very close to zero. And it turns out that for the Ising model, you can prove very generally that as beta increases toward beta c, so as the temperature decreases toward the critical temperature, as I already mentioned earlier, the correlation length blows up, which means that the inverse correlation length nu beta tends to zero for all direction s. Okay, so when beta approaches beta c, nu tends to zero. Now, the other limit that is of interest is when beta goes to zero. And here I will first discuss what happens in the case where you have super exponential decay of interactions, just to contrast it with what happens now in the case of exponential decay. So when beta goes to zero and you have interaction decaying faster than any exponential, then it's very easy to prove that the inverse correlation length diverges, which means that the correlation length tends to zero, which is not surprising because when beta is equal to zero, your spin are independent random variables. Okay, there is no correlation length, zero. Okay, so that's what you can show when you have interaction that decay faster than exponential. But now remember what I said in the previous slide. There was this observation by Widom that the two-point function can never decay faster than the interaction. Now we're looking at a situation where the interaction decays exponentially fast. Okay, so our two-point function cannot decay faster than this exponentially decaying interaction. Okay, and that means that in particular, the rate of exponential decay of the two-point function must be smaller or equal to the rate of exponential decay of the interaction, which was this triple norm. So we see that necessarily we must have nu beta, which is the rate of exponential decay of the two-point function, which must be smaller than the rate of exponential decay of the interaction, which is given by the triple norm. So this inequality should always be true. So it's always true. And therefore, this divergence cannot occur because nu is bounded, so it cannot diverge when beta goes to zero. In fact, what happens is that when beta goes to zero, nu beta of s converges to the maximal allowed value, which is the triple norm of s. This leads to two possible scenarios. On the one hand, what you might have is the following. So I have not said it, but this function nu beta, this function nu beta, the function of beta, it's non-increasing. So these are really the only two possibilities. So the first possibility is that for any beta larger than zero, you always have that nu beta of s is strictly smaller than the triple norm of s. So the rate of exponential decay of the two-point function is strictly faster than the rate of exponential decay of the interaction. It's only as the temperature grows to infinity, so when beta tends to zero, that the two rates converges one to the other. The other possibility is that, in fact, at very high temperature, you have a whole interval of temperatures at which the two rates of decay are equal. So nu beta of s is equal to the triple norm of s for all beta up to in some interval. Okay, and only after that does new beta of SDK towards zero when you get close to beta C. Okay. So let me introduce some terminology. So I will denote by beta sat of S. So beta saturation in direction S, a priori it might depend on the direction. I will define this as the supremum over all values of beta for which you have saturation, by which I mean that the two rate of exponential decay coincide. So when you have this interval here, the largest value, largest boundary of the interval, I call it beta sat of S. Okay. And I will say that there is saturation at temperature, inverse temperature beta, if beta is smaller than beta sat of S. Okay. In the sense that this function nu beta of S, which would very much like to diverge, cannot diverge because it has to stay smaller than the triple norm. So the only thing can do is saturate at this value. Okay. That's why saturation. Okay, one remark maybe before I change slides is that if this can happen, we have not proven yet that this can happen, but if this can happen, it has a very surprising consequence, which is that this function nu beta of S, this inverse correlation length, cannot be an analytic function of beta in the whole high temperature regime, that is in the whole interval zero beta C. Why? Well, because at beta sat, it's certainly not analytic. It's constant on one side. It's not constant on the other side. Okay, so it's you would have that the correlation length does not depend analytically on the temperature above the critical temperature, which is something that was not at all expected. In fact, the opposite was expected. So we'll see if this can happen. So in order to determine whether this is what happens or this is what happens, I need some criterion. And that's what I want to discuss now. So I will state the criterion that will allow us to decide whether there is a saturation regime or there is no saturation regime. To state this criterion, I need some definition. So I will first introduce two generating functions, which are defined on RD. So T will always be in RD. So the first is G beta of T. It's some generating function associated to the two-point function G beta of X. Then G of T will be J of T, sorry, will be associated to the coupling constant J of X. Okay, so the definition of G beta of T is just the sum of all vertices of the lattice, exponential of T scalar product X, then G beta of X. And the same for this function J of T. Okay, then I also need two sets which are associated to this triple norm that describes the exponential rate of decay of the interaction. The first one is very simple. It's just the unit ball for the triple norm. So U is just the unit ball for the triple norm. And then the set W is a bit more complicated if you've never seen this kind of things. It's what is called the polar set associated to U. It's kind of convex dual to the set U. It's defined as the set of all T in RD, such that for any X in RD, the scalar product between T and X is smaller than the triple norm of X. Okay, that's what it is. And one might wonder, why is this set relevant at all in our context? And the reason why it's relevant is that this set W, it's easy to check that this set W is actually the closure of the domain of convergence of this generating function J of T. It's an exercise to check that this is the case. So in particular, if you take T in the interior of W, J of T is finite. If you take T outside W, J is infinite. And if you take T on the boundary of W, you don't know. It depends. It's much more complicated what happens on the boundary. So let's assume that T is a point of the boundary of W here. If T is on the boundary of W, then there must exist some X in RD which saturates this inequality, such that this inequality is actually an identity. If I have such a pair, TX, then I will say that they are in duality. So that's what I've written here. So a point T in the boundary of W is dual to some direction S if the scalar product between T and S is equal to the triple norm of S. Observe that here, both sides are homogeneous in X, so I could normalize both X on both sides. So it's enough to look at directions. Okay, here I have an illustration, graphical illustration of what happens. So in the case where the triple norm is just the L1 norm, so that's the unit ball for the L1 norm, then the polar set W is just the unit ball for the L infinity norm in this case. And now if I take as a direction one of the lattice directions, say E1, like in this picture, then it's easy to check that all the points in this side of the square are dual to this direction S. If you take now a direction S, which is not in one of the lattice directions, like here, for instance, then you can see that there is only one direction T, one point T on the boundary of W, which is dual to S, which is the corner. or which corner depends on the S that I choose, but it will be the corner. So that's to highlight the fact that this duality relation is not a one-to-one map between T and a point T on the boundary of W and the direction S. Indeed, in this case, you have one S and many Ts, and here you have one T and many S. Okay? The only case where you have a one-to-one map is when the boundary of this set W is C1, okay? Which might happen or might not happen. Okay, so now I think I have all the ingredients I need to state this criterion that I promised. So that's one of the results with Yacine, Dima, and Sébastien. So fix the direction S and denote by TS the set of all points in the boundary of W which are dual to S in the sense I've just introduced. Then beta sat of S is strictly positive. So there is in direction S, you have a non-trivial saturation regime. So like in this picture here, so if this is what happens in direction S, if and only if among all these T's which are dual to S, there is at least one for which G of T is finite. Remember that for T in the boundary of W, whether G of T is finite or not is undecided a priori. So here, if you can find at least one T dual to S such that G of T is finite, then this condition is equivalent to having a non-trivial saturation regime. Okay. So there are several interesting consequences to that. The first one is that, as I will explain in a minute, this condition which is here can be satisfied. Always in any dimension, you can find prefactor psi to your exponential decay such that you will indeed have a non-trivial saturation regime. This means that this remark about the fact that the correlation length might depend non-analytically on beta in the high temperature regime actually occurs in reality. So it really occurs, and which is already very surprising. And it's even more surprising when you realize that it also occurs in dimension one. So in dimension one, it has been known at least since the 70s there were papers by Dobrushin and Ruel, for instance, that if you take one dimensional system with exponentially decaying interaction, then basically everything is analytic at any temperature. So all the thermodynamic potential are analytic. If you take a local observable, its expectation with respect to the Gibbs measure will be analytic in beta and so on. So everything is analytic, but what we show here is that the correlation length can be non-analytic at some temperature in dimension one. Okay, so that's the first thing I wanted to say. The second thing is that although I stated this result only for the Ising model, in the paper we established it for a very large class of models. In particular, we prove it for the POTS models, for the XY model, for FK percolation, for the Gaussian free field, where instead of playing with beta as a parameter that we change, we play with the mass of the Gaussian free field. But you can also take the Ising model, but instead of playing with beta, you play with the magnetic field, you fix beta and you play with the magnetic field, and so on. So it's a very general result. We expect it to be completely generic. Now, let me say a bit more about what you can extract from this criterion, almost for free. So remember, psi was this prefactor to the exponential decay of the interactions, the coupling constant. So if this prefactor, if you sum the value of this prefactor over the positive integers and this diverges, then this tells you immediately that there is no saturation regime in any direction S. On the other hand, if you look instead at psi of L times L to the power D minus one, and you sum this over all positive integers, and this is finite, then you conclude immediately that non-trivial saturation regime in every direction S. Okay, so this really shows that both behavior can occur depending on the choice of the prefactor. Of course, there is a big gap between these two conditions I've stated here. So it would be nice to be able to say something explicit, but this form of the criterion is not very convenient to say something general. It's a bit too abstract. So it would be nice to have a more explicit criterion. And that's what I want to explain now. So I will start with explaining a local parameterization of how we parameterize locally the boundary of the unit ball. So I make the picture in dimension two, but of course can be any dimension. So this red curve represents the boundary of the unit ball for the triple norm. Then you fix some direction S and you denote by S naught the point of the boundary of the unit ball, which is in direction S. So S naught is just S over the triple norm of S. Okay. So that's the point S naught. And then at S naught, you look at the tangent plane. Okay, if the boundary of U is not smooth, it's not differentiable at S naught, then you take any fixed supporting hyperplane here, doesn't matter. but let's say a tangent plane for simplicity. And then I can parameterize the boundary of U as follows. So you take an arbitrary unit vector V in this hyperplane. Okay? And then you take a small number tau, positive. And then you look at the point tau V on the hyperplane, which is here. And you look how far the unit ball is from the hyperplane at this point or below this point, which I call f of tau v. Okay, so this function f of tau v, it provides a local parametrization of the boundary of u close to s naught if you can do this for all small values of tau. So this is completely general. You can always do that. Now I'm going to make an assumption, which is not always true. So I'm going to assume that there exist two constants, big C and small c, which are positive, and a function g, which is non-negative and non-decreasing, such that this function f of tau v that appears here is bounded below by small c times g of tau. It's bounded above by big C times g of tau. So this means that, intuitively, it means that the qualitative behavior of the boundary of u in all directions is roughly the same. So you have a kind of rough isotropy of the boundary of u at S0, at the point S0. Okay. Then if this assumption is verified, so u is a convex body, so it's satisfied almost everywhere in any case. But okay, if the assumption is satisfied, then you have a more explicit version of the criterion. What you can show is that beta sat of S is strictly positive, so we have a non-trivial saturation regime in direction S, if and only if this completely explicit series is finite. So psi, remember, is the prefactor to the exponential decay of the coupling constant J. And this G minus one here is the inverse of the function G, which appears here in the description of the qualitative behavior of the boundary of U at S naught. And D minus one is just a dimension minus one. And so this is completely explicit. So let me show you what this tells you in a particular example. So let's look at the Ising model on Z2 with J of X, which is given by exponential of minus the LP norm of X, where, for some P, which I assume to be larger than two, to have something interesting to say later. So the triple norm now is the LP norm, and the prefactor, which is the LP norm to the power alpha. So that's the behavior I want for the JX. Alpha is any fixed real number. Then you can take a direction S, so we're in dimension two, so it's just a unit vector in R2. Let's denote S naught as before as the corresponding point on the boundary of the unit ball for the LP norm. X naught and Y naught are its components. Then you can compute the extension of the Taylor extension of this F of tau V, which describes the local parametrization of the boundary. And you get that it's a positive constant times tau square plus higher order corrections, provided X naught and Y naught are non-zero. So if you exclude the direction on the lattice, the axis directions, then you have a behavior which is quadratic. So you can take G of tau to be tau square. And then if you look at the criterion which I showed in the previous slide, you conclude that beta sat of S is strictly positive if and only if this explicit series is convergent, which means that alpha is smaller than minus 3/2. Now you could look at the other direction, the four remaining directions along the axis. And then if you Taylor expand F, you find that it behaves like 1 over p tau to the power p plus higher order terms. So g of tau can be taken to be tau to the power p. And then the criterion becomes that alpha is smaller than 1 over p minus 2. So this has two immediate consequences. The first one is that whether or not there is a non-trivial saturation regime, and a fortiori, what is the value of beta sat of S, depends on the choice of the norm. Right? The p appears explicitly here. And second, it also depends explicitly on the direction. Indeed, I have chosen p to be larger than 2, strictly larger than 2. So this number here is strictly smaller than minus 3/2. So I have a gap between minus 3/2 and this number. And if I choose the exponent alpha in this gap, then I conclude that there is no saturation regime in the axis direction, but there is a saturation regime in all the other directions. So this shows that you really have a non-trivial directional effect on these issues. So that's all I wanted to say about the saturation problem. What has it to do with Einstein-Zernike, which is the topic of this talk? The point is the following. So if beta sat of S is strictly positive, so if you take a direction in which there is a saturation regime, then what we can prove is that for sufficiently high temperature, Einstein-Zernike fails. And so that at arbitrarily high temperature in this case, the Einstein-Zernike prediction fails, which is exactly a domain where it was certainly expected to hold. So we are not able to treat any prefactor psi, you are able to treat classes like stretch exponential or things like exponential of minus a power of log or power law with an exponent larger than the dimension, things like that. So for various classes of prefactor psi, we can prove the following. So if beta sat is positive in direction S and psi is like that, then for all beta small enough, the two-point function behaves exactly as the coupling constant J. Okay, so this immediately tells you that Zernike is violated because the coupling constant, okay, decays exponentially, but the prefactor is given by psi, and psi is not of the form 1 over the distance to power d minus 1 over 2. In any of these cases, this is violated. Right? So we are still working on this issue. There are many things that we would like to be able to say more about. For instance, we would like to be able to say more about treat more general classes of prefactor. We would like to be able to extend this this violation of Einstein-Zernike. We would like to extend it in the whole regime between zero and beta sat, not just for small values of beta. Certainly it will be true, but we don't know how to do it in general yet. We would like to get matching, asymptotically matching upper and lower bounds. And we would like to show that this violation of Einstein-Zernike is really related to this saturation phenomenon. And if you look at what happens for beta larger than beta sat, then we expect to have Einstein-Zernike. We can prove it in some cases, but not in full generality now. And we also expect that Einstein-Zernike behavior typically also holds at beta sat. Now, in the remaining few minutes, I want to give some comments on the proof. And what I will do is I will actually prove you completely this saturation, this criterion for saturation in dimension one, because in dimension one, the geometry is trivial, and this makes the argument much simpler. So let me start with some preliminaries. So when beta is smaller than beta c, the two-point function admits many geometrical representation, and the one I will use is the so-called high-temperature representation that tells you that the two-point function is equal to the sum over all self-voiding passes gamma, starting at zero and ending up at x, of some complicated weight q beta of gamma, which is non-negative. Now, I said that these weights are complicated, that's true, but they satisfy nice inequalities. So if gamma is the path gamma zero, gamma one, up to gamma n, so gamma zero is zero, gamma n is x, okay? So if that's my path, then the weight of q beta of gamma, is bounded above by the product over all edges in this path, so all increments along this path, of beta times the corresponding coupling constant, so j of gamma I minus gamma I minus one. And it's bounded below by something which is completely analog, except that you replace beta by a more complicated function of beta, which is strictly positive. Okay, so you have these inequalities. Second thing I would like to say is that remember the definition of these two generating functions, so g beta and jt, g beta of t and j of t, which are here. So we're in dimension one, so the sum is over x in z. The scalar product is just the usual product, okay, both cases. Now, remember that g beta of x by what we said earlier decays to leading order. It decays exponentially fast with a rate which is given by nu beta of 1 times the absolute value of x. And then j of x decays to leading order like with a rate which is given by the triple norm of 1. Okay. So from this observation, you can immediately compute the radius of convergence of these two series, g beta and j. What you conclude is that g beta has a radius of convergence which is given by nu beta of 1, and g has a radius of convergence which is given by the triple norm of 1. Okay. Now, one comment I would like also to make is that I already told you before that the rate of exponential decay of the two-point function should never be larger than the rate of exponential decay of the interaction. Actually, this can be seen very easily from 1 and 2. So I told you that the weights q are strictly positive, are non-negative, sorry. And that means that if I restrict the sum here to some specific passes, then I get a lower bound on g beta. So what I can do is that I can restrict the sum to a single pass, which is the simplest possible path going from 0 to x. It's the path composed of of just one edge, which is the edge 0x. Okay. So if I do that, if I lower bound this by just this single pass, and I use this lower bound here to get an estimate on q beta of this path composed of just a single edge, then I get that g beta of x is larger than c beta times jx. And from this, it immediately follows that the rate of exponential decay of g is smaller or equal to the rate of exponential decay of j, which is what is written here. Okay. Now, the last thing I want to say is the following. So g beta of t by definition is given by this. That's the definition of g beta. Now, I can replace g beta of x here, the two-point function, by this graphical representation. Now, this sum over gamma, I can make it explicit. So I'm summing first over the number of steps, number of increments in gamma. Then I'm summing over the size of all these increments, y1 up to yn. These are the increments of my path. Of course, I want the path to end at x, so the sum of all the increments yk has to be equal to x. And then I get q beta of the resulting path. That's just the path given by all these increments. Okay, but then I have this e to the power tx, but x is the sum over yk. So I can replace it by e to the power t times y1 plus y2 plus yn, right? So now x has disappeared from everywhere. It's only here in the constraint. So when I sum over x here, this makes the constraint disappear. And in the end, I end up with this very simple expression for the generating function. Okay. This will be used twice in the SQL. So now let's state the criterion in dimension one. So there are only two unit vectors in dimension one. It's one and minus one. Without loss of generality, I take one. Then it's immediate to check that the set of dual vectors to this direction S is just the triple norm of one. There is only one element. Therefore, the criterion that I stated earlier becomes simply that you have a non-trivial saturation regime if and only if the generating function J evaluated at this triple norm of one is finite. And I will prove this to you. It's an equivalent, so I will prove both implications. Very simple. So let's first prove that J of triple norm of one is finite, then beta sat of one is strictly positive. Then what I'm going to use is this representation of G beta of T, okay? And the upper bound that I stated here, which allows me to replace Q by this product over the increment of beta times the corresponding J. Okay, so I can replace this Q by the product. And what I get is the following. So you get the sum over the length of the path gamma, sum over the increment, and then you get this product. So the ETYK is the one that was already there. It's this one. And then this beta JYK is what comes from the upper bound on the weight Q. But here you see that everything is factorized. So this I can rewrite it as sum over n, beta JT to the power n. Right? So now if J of T is finite and beta is sufficiently small, say smaller than 1 over J of T, then the product beta J is strictly smaller than 1, and this series is summable, which means that G beta of T is finite. Which means that, so that's true in general, but now I know that for triple norm of 1, if you take T equals triple norm of 1, I know that it's finite by assumption. So I know that this is finite. From this argument, I conclude that G beta evaluated at triple norm of 1 is finite for all beta smaller than 1 over J of triple norm of 1. But remember, so this means that triple norm of one is in the domain of convergence of G beta, which means that it's smaller than the radius of convergence, smaller or equal to the radius of convergence, give me this inequality. But we have already seen that the reverse inequality always holds. So this means that they must be actually equal. So if they are both equal, that means that at inverse temperature beta, I have a saturation. Both rate of exponential decay coincide. And this happens for all interval of inverse temperatures beta, which means that beta sat of one is strictly positive. It's actually larger than this number. Okay. So this proves the first implication. The second one is very similar. So assume that J is infinite. J evaluated at triple norm of one is infinite. And then want to show that beta sat of one is zero. And what you do is you fix some beta positive. Then an easy application of FAT2 shows that because J evaluated at this point is infinite, if you evaluate it at one minus epsilon times this point, you can make this quantity as large as you want, provided you take epsilon small enough. And in particular, you can make it larger than 2 over C beta. C beta was just this constant which appears in the lower bound on the weights. Okay, you will see where it appears in the argument. So let me call this point 1 minus epsilon times the triple norm of 1. Let me call it T. And if you do that, then we get the following. So I use this representation we had before. So G beta of T is the sum over all passes, the length of all paths of the passes. Then I have the sum over the increments. Notice that now I've added the restrictions. I'm only summing over increments which are positive. Instead of summing over all possible values of the increment, I'm only summing over positive increments. Okay. This I can certainly always do. This gives me a lower bound. Then I get this product over. So the Cβ jyk comes from the lower bound on the weight, and this Etyk is there as before. It's already there in the representation of Gβ. Okay. Again, everything is factorized. So this you can write as the sum over n of Cβ times the sum of over y greater or equal 1, jy Ety to the power n. Now, this is almost the generating function J of t, except that I'm only summing over y positive, while in J of t, I'm summing over all y's. But notice that t is a positive number. So the contribution coming from the positive y's is always larger than the contribution coming from the negative y's. So this sum is larger than 1/2 J of t. Okay. But now, remember how I've chosen t. So I've chosen t in such a way that J of t is larger than 2 over C beta. So this product here of these three factors is larger than 1. So the series is divergent. So you conclude that this point t, 1 minus epsilon times triple norm of 1, is outside the domain of convergence of G beta of t. So this means that it must be larger or equal to the radius of convergence. But epsilon is strictly positive. So that means that the triple norm of 1 has to be strictly larger than nu beta of 1. But this means that you don't have saturation at inverse temperature beta, but beta was completely arbitrary. It's any positive number. So you never have saturation. So that means that beta sat of 1 is 0. So let me just make in 1 minute, this concludes the proof, but let me make one final comment because it might interest some people in the audience. It's something that remains at the moment very heuristic. We don't have a satisfactory treatment of this. Final remark, but I would like to explain that this transition, say when you cross, when beta crosses beta sat, and you go from a regime where you have Einstein-Zernike behavior to a regime where you have non-Einstein-Zernike behavior, that it's related to a condensation phenomenon. And the idea is as follows. So when beta is larger than beta sat, what one can show is that a typical passes gamma that contribute to the two-point function between 0 and x are composed of microscopic steps. And the number of steps you have, since they are all microscopic, it's scaling, it's of order x. You have of order x steps in passes contributing to this two-point function. But when beta is smaller than beta sat, what you can show is that typical passes have a number of steps which is smaller of x, which means that you will have some giant steps among these guys. Actually, we expect to have something much more drastic, so we expect that for many prefactors, we expect to have actually a giant step going from a neighborhood of zero to a neighborhood of x. But these are things that we don't know how to establish yet for the Ising model in general, say for general temperatures and general prefactors. But this is very reminiscent to this of this condensation phenomena that you have for sums of ID random variable with heavy tails, for instance. Okay, I will stop here. I'm sorry that I took a bit longer than planned.
Oh, thank you very much, Ivan. So maybe you can unmute your microphones and to thank Ivan for this very nice talk. And now we are open for questions. So anyone? Well, I can start with some questions. So in this path that you presented at the end, so do you expect to be able to prove some scaling limit of the typical path, or is this?
Well, what we expect is exactly what you have for this phenomena for heavy tails random variables. So you expect that in this region, so here it will be a Brownian motion. So I mean Brownian bridge. So this regime is very well understood. Very well understood. When Einstein-Zernike applies, the whole theory we have developed with Dima and Massimo allows to do this kind of things, in principle at least. In this regime, on the other hand, you expect that for many prefactors, which are not too singular, so when you have enough moments and things like that, you expect to have a single giant jump that goes from essentially zero to essentially x. So the scaling limit, and you have this big jump regime where you have essentially just one random variable which takes the whole contribution. All the other ones are just microscopic. So we'll just see a giant step going from zero to x for most prefactors. Then you probably have also, as you have for this heavy tails phenomena, other regimes where you maybe have several of these big jumps and things like that. We don't know yet exactly. the results we have up to now are very limited. So we have, in some cases, for classes of prefactors, we can say something about how small the number of steps you have here. For example, for if the prefactor is a power law, we can show that we have a logarithmic, at most, a logarithmic number of steps, log x step. But it's still very weak. So we are working on that.
Then in dimension one, so the proof you presented relies very much on this formula you have for the generating function. So this is the same approach you have in higher dimension.
The proof is essentially identical. The only thing is that you have to use more convex geometry to play with, to replace these arguments that I use with radius of convergence and things like that. You have to play with convex geometry. So you have to introduce also the unit ball and its polar set, not only for the triple norm of one, which was the rate of decay of the interaction, but also the one which corresponds to the rate of decay of the two-point function. And you have to use the interplay between these two unit balls and these two polar sets to make this argument work. But conceptually, it's exactly the same proof. It's just a bit more technical because the geometry is more involved.
Then something I might have missed is that, so we have this beta saturation, which depends on the direction. So yes. You know how it depends on the direction? Is it a smooth dependence on, as a function on the sphere or?
Well, probably because what happened is that, so if you're in higher dimension, so I told you, you have these two unit balls. So you have the unit ball for the interaction. This one is fixed. It's given, you fix your interaction at the start of the problem, and then you have a unit ball associated to your norm, triple norm. And then you have another unit ball, which is associated to the two-point function, the rate of decay of the two-point function, this new beta that I introduced. And this one, of course, it depends on beta. And when beta decreases, you get, it becomes smaller and smaller. It's always outside the unit ball of the interaction because there is this inequality between the new and the triple norm that I mentioned. So it's always out, it lies always out, it always contains the unit ball of the interaction, but it remains outside, but it starts decreasing in size. And saturation occurs when they start touching somewhere, but they cannot touch in principle, they should not be able to touch in this continuous manner. So we expect everything to behave in a very continuous way. For geometrical reasons, it's simply the evolution of this new beta, the function new beta is continuous in beta. So the corresponding unit ball will behave continuously in beta. So everything must be continuous, but can be very complicated as a function of S for a fixed beta on the other end.
All right. Well, thanks. Any other questions?
I can ask a question. Hi, that was a fantastic talk. I'm very happy I lucked into it. Thank you. And just as a comment, I wish some of you guys would write a book about the Ising model. There's such an amazing amount of stuff that is available. I know Dominique Copin is threatening to do a multi-volume.
Yes, they started something some years ago. I don't know if it does advance much.
Right. But you know, how does an outsider figure out what's going on? Because there's just so much amazing work. It's just beautiful.
So I know that Barry Simon is writing the second part of his book.
Oh, sure.
So there will be some aspects of these tools that will be introduced, but I think he will not touch very recent results. So
he might, but it was 40 years ago that he wrote volume one, right, or something.
He has restarted working on the second
one. That's good to know. A question is, are there any efforts at getting off infinity? That is, it's very natural, but everything is set on an infinite graph or infinite limits, and is there any sort of more quantitative? Now that would be very hard to do, but is there some domain in which somebody is working on, if the box is of size n, then this approximately holds, something like that?
Well, okay, if you want to be really quantitative with explicit constant and so on, probably it's a bit tricky, but everything I said here for the infinite volume limit, you can do it for big enough boxes. The point is that I have exponential decay of correlations always. So if my 2.0 and x are sufficiently far away from the boundary, these passes that I've drawn here, for instance, or there, uh-huh. they will not even realize that there is a boundary.
Right.
Because it costs so much to go close to the boundary because of the exponential decay of correlations that all these results will just be exactly the same in finite volumes.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you. That's great. Thanks.
Welcome.
Any other question? Well, if not, let's thank the speaker again. Thank you, Yvan. And so let me remind you that next week we continue with Servet-Martinez on quasi-potential. Thank you and see you next week.
Thank you, Claudio. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.